Hi, and welcome to Books in Action. My name is Larry Petraccaro, and I have with me two of our other hosts, Melissa Kopecky, who's the director of the South Orange Public Library, and Jonah Zimiles, who is the owner of Words Bookstore. And even though the three of us in general, and usually, you know, interview authors and other people associated with books or with words, you know, the written or the spoken, newspapers, magazines, tonight we thought we would talk a little bit about just books in general. And if you can see, maybe able to see that both Melissa and Jonah have brought a number of books. So I thought the way we'd get started would be to talk about books sort of in chronological order in the sense that we'll start with children's books and then maybe move to young adult books and then go to adult books and then maybe finish it off with nonfiction. So both Jonah and Melissa have bought a number of books. So let's start off with children's books. So maybe, Jonah, do you have a children's book that you could show us?
Well, here, this book is called Mix It Up. And as I hope you can see, it's got beautiful illustrations about what happens when you mix various colors together. And this is a best-selling book, and it's been selling like crazy at our bookstore all across the country.
It's got nice texture pages too.
Correct.
Like painting paper, like almost like finger paint paper pages. So sturdier for kids, but also you get sort of a little tactile thing going there. Can I park this over here?
Please do.
And what age do you think that might be for? I mean, so you have like three colors on one page, and those come together to make a different color?
Yeah, I mean younger kids.
Well, except that if you're doing a whole assorted group of kids and about to do an art project, how cool to look at that and just appreciate the beautiful colors, and then they're remembering how to mix all the colors they're going to use. I like this book. I don't like to put ages on books with pictures. I think everybody should enjoy them.
Okay. But I wanted to contrast.
Oh,
with
that. How perfect. Okay. What a lead-up.
Contrast it with B.J. Novak's... B.J. Novak was a writer on The Office and was an actor on The Office. Mm-hmm. He's written a huge hit book for kids called The Book with No Pictures. And it's, as you might imagine, quite funny.
It's got words.
But it's got words. Got colors.
Funny words.
And funny, funny words.
Funny words.
Funny words. But this has been one of, again, a big seller and an extremely popular book. See, celebrity books, you know, really kind of vary both in quality and in terms of how popular they are. And this is one that's, a lot of celebrities try to write kids' books and they're not always so popular. Perfect.
This is a great page because you see the different color, the different fonts, the exclamation points. And that's something I would say probably everybody knows, the true story of the big bad wolf and the stinky cheese man and all of those. I mean, there were people who really, John Skiza and Lane Smith, who really pushed the limits on using the whole page and using the font and the colors as well as the illustrations to tell the story. So it's very cool that it's sort of pared back down. Okay, I can stop talking now.
No.
But I love it. I mean, kids learn exclamation points from books like this. I mean, you can tell just from looking at the word what an exclamation point means. And so it's, I'm using that to segue into this book, which is called Exclamation. But, and what it says on the back is we all have an inner exclamation mark. The question is how to find it. But I have to say, we were sort of looking at stuff from 2014, this year's books. And I think this is a year or two back. But 2014 will be the year that I discovered this pairing of husband and wife. I think she had written some books, and
who,
he hadn't.
Who are the
and they've done a few over the last couple of years. One is Duck Rabbit. One is, this is one just her with a different illustrator. They did Spoon, and then they did Chopsticks, which I had loved. But these are, they're just fun. They're clever. Talk about the no words or the use of things. And we have it on the old composition paper. And, but here, these exclamation marks actually are, you know, coming alive. They're just really well done. So that's sort of a book with no pictures.
There you go.
I'll give you that one back. And you have another one.
Yeah, well, I always like to feature at least one or two books by local authors. And one of them, here's a kid's book by local author Jennifer Vogel-Bass. She's a Maplewoodian, I believe, called Edible Colors.
Mm.
And as we know, it's very important for us to eat colorful foods. They're very healthy, and it's a lot of fun for kids, too. And so here, I mean, this is the one talking about carrots are orange. They're also purple.
Hmm.
And then it shows you all different types of purple foods.
That's amazing. I mean, I always thought all carrots were orange, so I've learned something this evening.
There you go.
I mean, I was pretty pleased when just a few months ago I learned that not all tomatoes were red. You know, some of these heirloom tomatoes are very different colors.
Did you know cauliflower?
For example, here's the
yellow.
There
we go,
yeah,
the tomato, orange cauliflower. Right. I was just about to say that. You did the right page.
Do you have any thoughts about what makes a good children's book? I mean, is it the colors in it? Is it the size of the letters or the words? Or
well, you can answer first, and then I always enough to say.
No, I don't
okay.
Think about white.
It might be an unfair question, but I was just curious. It just was one of the things that came to my mind.
I think a picture book, it's about the whole package. Mm-hmm. So for it to be really a classic, it has to not only have great words and great pictures and the right layout, but they all have to be perfect for each other. So I think that there are books that are beautiful, there are books you learn something from. There are the strangest and really awful books that your kid picks up somewhere and you're like, oh, I have to read that to him, and then it becomes their favorite book, but hopefully just for a month or two. Hmm. So, I mean, you wouldn't ask that question about an adult book, right? Because
kids' books,
there's fiction, there's nonfiction, yeah. And then you have the whole different levels of readers as well. So that's a whole nother complexity that's not, because you have books with controlled vocabulary, which is what we would think of as easy readers, that like mm-hmm. the I can read books that Dr. Seuss
yeah.
only
Danny
called
the
himself Theodore Geisel yeah. when he did those. Yeah, all of those classic ones, that's a controlled vocabulary. So that's for the kid who's learning to read. It's really important, even while the kid is doing that on their own, that's when reading is still work, that you then have picture books that have way more complex vocabulary, which are some of the coolest books of all. And you wouldn't read them to the kid that you would think you would read. And now I think even more, just like animated movies, like they're designed for the parents and the adults and the teenagers to appreciate as much as the kids. There's like lots of layers in it.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that is part of a kid's book. But some, you know, you just want, some are meant to be read aloud. I'm going to throw in this one, Baby's Got the Blues, because it has lovely, cute illustrations. And it is. It is meant to be read aloud, but it also has lots of pictures you could go back to and see everything all the kids in it are doing. But when you read it, you've got a blues story about baby's got the blues. You know, baby can't do anything all the slightly older kids can do.
Mm-hmm.
But just lots of detail in very simple, and he's paying his dues, he's got the locked up baby blues. So it's just the words flow. It's a great one for reading aloud, and of course it ends nicely.
Well, that's the best part, right?
Yes.
So one of the books that, you know, it's obviously not here because it's a really old book, but one that I've liked to give as a present, you know, to little kids or when they're newborn is The Carrot Seed. I don't know if you're familiar with that one, but it's just got such a, and the reason I like that is because I like the message. I like the fact that the little boy is persistent, doesn't necessarily pay attention to all the advice he's got, and it turns out in the end that he's right. So I've given that as a gift probably 4, 5, 6 times, you know, because I just think it's such a nice story.
Well, and I would guess that would be and I'm sure people have done lots of studies on it, but what makes a great children's book? If the books we read when we were little are still in print,
yeah, I guess.
Those are great children's books. I mean, there's the cats, hats, I mean.
Caps for sale,
yeah, yes, thank you. And millions of cats.
How about the color kittens? Do you remember that one? The color kittens?
Those were the golden books and
yeah.
Those were the ones that, like, finally every kid could afford to have books because they sold them at the grocery store.
Yeah. Yeah.
They were home in Wisconsin, and they have the original, like a whole museum at a library. They
really?
Have all the copies of all those golden books.
All the old golden books.
Some of whom were like really good artists and illustrators or went on to make huge names for themselves, but they were founded with the idea that every family should be able to afford books for their kids, which is cool.
Yeah.
So I've got a different type of answer to your question.
Okay.
We're going from sort of one, perhaps, way of looking at it to another. This book is called The Story of Mankind. It's just been recently put back into print by Henrik van Loon. And this is a pretty long, over 700-page history of mankind, and my father would read this to me when I was a kid, little kid, and I loved it because it's got very vivid language and it tells great stories about things in history, and sure enough, I grew up to be a history major in college, and maybe it was because my father read this. So books that are what, quote-unquote, makes a good kid's book, I'm not disagreeing with you at all, but I'm amplifying it that it can be what's traditionally thought of as a kid's book, but where it could be something that you wouldn't ordinarily think of as a kid's book. In fact, this was written originally for the author's grandchildren because he liked telling them history stories.
Oh,
really?
So, that's wonderful.
So how old is it, Jonah? When was it originally published?
I don't know, but the author died in 1944.
Well, it's okay.
gives us a hint. And he was doing that to his grandchildren.
And that was before, contrary to what some of the people who work in a bookstore think, that was before I was born. So,
me too.
Me too, for that matter. So we have time maybe for one more children's book, if you brought one to listen.
Oh, and I was going to say, to go back to my whole thing about all the different kinds, there's children's nonfiction,
mm-hmm.
too.
Right.
And that's I just picked this one up as a recent one, but biographies for children have gone through now. I bet you guys remember reading Life of Famous Americans? It was stories of, they had silhouettes on the cover, and it was stories of Pocahontas or George Washington or whatever, about them when they were kids.
I love
them. So you were supposed to bond? Right, they were great. But if you picked them up now, you'd be like, this is such total fiction. So now people are more careful about telling the story, but when it's done in a picture book format, you just get these beautiful things, and they usually have sourcing at the end. So if you want to go read more, you know where the information came from. And this is cool because it has the sketchy kind of pages as well.
Mm-hmm.
There's an Edison one called A Beam of Light that is just one of the most beautiful books of the year, but it was checked out, which is a good thing.
So I couldn't bring it.
Well, I'm from Nyack, where Edward Hopper lived and had houses, so I'm glad you
really came. Oh, cool.
Well, speaking of checked out, we're going to have to check out for a minute, but if you'll stay with us, we'll be back shortly.
After 17 years working as a mason, Mike was laid off. I met him when he came into the library looking for help. He found a job opening, but the application was only online. Mike said he'd spent his entire life around tools, but had never used a computer. I showed him how, and he ended up applying for numerous jobs online. I saw Mike the other day. His new computer skills paid off. He's working again.
New Jersey libraries are transforming lives. Tell us your story.
Hi, and welcome back to Books in Action. This is Larry Petraccaro, and with me, Melissa Kopecky of the South Orange Public Library, and Jonah Zimiles of Words Bookstore. And we spent the first half of the show talking about children's books. And I had said at the beginning that maybe we'd try to work our way chronologically up through young adult, adult, and then maybe into some nonfiction. So I think to try to keep that promise, let's talk a little bit about young adult books. Jonah, you seem to have one at hand.
Well, just as we transition from younger kids to young adults, I just want to mention Jeff Kinney's latest book, A Diary of a Wimpy Kid, The Long Haul. Phenomenally popular. Jeff's a great guy. It's a lot of fun. And
well, then, the Wimpy Kid books are all pretty popular, aren't they? I mean, it's...
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yep. And we enjoyed, this was an author who's been recently in the store, and I just love the title of this book, 120 Ways to Annoy Your Mother and Influence People. So that qualifies as YA, though it's actually written for an audience both, you know, of YA and older young people, particularly young women, and it's got a very, you can see again, it's colorful and... And it's got a very a real snarky attitude that I like a lot. And so for example, how to be rebellious within the confines of society. And it lists a few things, but one of the ones I like is randomly get really self-righteous, then quickly concede. And it has, I hate, crossed out, love the man, fight the power, but only a little. So I thought this book was very funny.
I like the push people's metaphysical boundaries.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say, what's interesting too is the choice of fonts. I think that seems to reinforce what you were saying about it being a little snarky, because just looking at the way that the letters were drawn and so forth, it just kind of makes you think that there's going to be something about this that's a little... You know, not off kilter, but let's say a little pushing the boundaries or so.
And I think this is her, it's not her first book, but she's an illustrator, and so that's why the print and a graphic designer, and that's why the illustration.
So she did the whole thing.
Well, I'll jump in. You know, the whole series thing, again, that's something that kids always love. Series,
correct.
It's a great thing because. And it doesn't matter that you're sucking up the series because you're probably reading individual things too, but sometimes you want to pick up something and you have a sense of, I'm going to like this before you've read it. There's a growing number of series. I honestly can't keep up with them. I am one of the YA readers at the library.
Wow.
I cannot keep up with series. Sometimes I'll grab a random one because to me, if you can just grab a random book from a series and it reads well, then that's a pretty good sign of the series that, you know, oh, it's okay. You know, it's not filled all with backstory, but you get a sense of the backstory and it's well written. So there's so many of those for YA, which there used to not be. So that's a wonderful trend. And then there's just some great... authors that everything they've written, Laurie Halse Anderson, and this was her newest, which I actually read and really, really liked. This was another book that I totally loved, The Museum of Intangible Things, and I have to say, she wrote a book before it, great titles, called The Probability of Miracles, which I've been meaning to go read because I enjoyed this so much. Just great vocabulary, great sort of getting your brain looping off in a little bit different way.
What are they about? I mean,
both of these are the main character is a woman, and it's this is two girls actually, and it's just sort of working through their lives and kind of thoughtful things. This one was a little more traumatic because. This is a relationship between a girl and her father, and he kind of goes off the bend, and she kind of... So this is a more veteran he is, and this is sort of more of traumatic action sort of thing, but they're both just very thoughtful books. You get engaged in what's happening with the characters, but they give you things that you sit and think about for a little bit.
Can I ask you a question before you go?
Absolutely.
Are young adult books getting more lifelike in a sense? Because I had a friend that we were talking about books for children and young adults, and she thought that the older books that were written, maybe Little House on the Prairie or that time frame, tended to be more realistic because they dealt with things like death and so forth more forthrightly then there, she seemed to imply that there was a sequence in time where some of these more difficult aspects of life were just kind of fudged over a little bit. And I wonder if you saw anything like that.
Well, that's absolutely true. And I think that probably happens for you, too, when you're recommending books. And it's really hard to do it for age. Because, right, can somebody, is a kid of any age ready to be dealing with death, or, you know, and how directly, or does it need to be oblique? And I my feeling is the more they read, they're going to find some thoughts that work for them. But what's the John part-time, Green. the absolutely true diary of a part-time Indian, which is always on the on the banned books list. People request it be removed from school libraries or this or that. And, you know, I saw it pop up again this year on the banned request list. And I thought, but I read that book and I thought it was a great book. Why does it keep ending on the banned list? So I read it again. I picked it up and I'm like, oh yeah, it has alcoholism. It has drugs. It has, you know, somebody ends up crashing and dying when they were driving drunk, and you know, all this. But to me, it was such a, yeah, if you're reading a realistic book, that's, that should be in there. But then again, maybe it's more than some people are ready to deal with. So there are certainly very, very realistic, there are very explicit books on all different levels of violence and sex and language, but there are also ones toned down. I mean, there's so much gradation now. It's such a big field.
In fact, what's ironic now is that adults are reading YA books.
Yes, yes,
and
yes.
And, you know, so if anything, I think the trend is to make them more appropriate for adults.
And I think the mysterious case of the dog at the UC, you probably remember titles. The Dog Who Barked
no,
in the Night.
No, Curious Mark Incident. Yeah.
Curious Incident. Hey. Right. Okay. Mark Halpern, right? That was actually marketed, had two different marketing campaigns, one for, that was but about 4 years ago, one for teens and one for adults, because it was perfect for either group. And maybe that's good that the boundaries are disappearing. But I have to say, I love the realistic and thoughtful kind of stuff. I also like fantasy. I do historic fiction. Like I said, I'll pull a vampire book out of a series, one of the, you know, odd ones, and just see what it's like, because I try to get a range. So here was one, When Mr. Dog Bites. It's British, and usually I love, like, British or Australian. You get a little sense of the different language, and I don't know if that complicated things for me, but it's a book about Tourette's, and it's
Tourette's
young,
syndrome?
Yes,
okay.
A kid with Tourette's. So it's pretty, you know, all over the place in that sense. I felt so much like I was in a young guy's brain that I kept putting the book down. Like, I can't read this. I just can't read this. And I'd be like, no, I can do this. I can do it. So I just sort of showed this because now I really want to hand it to a young guy and say, tell me what you think of this. Like, it was difficult for me.
Right.
So that's right. One of you guys has to bring it home and tell me. And, okay, let's move on to adult.
Want to move on to adults?
Yes.
Okay, so what do we have for adult? Jonah, did you bring any adult book with you?
Lots of adult books.
Oh, about great stuff.
Lots of adult books. I tend to like nonfiction books, so this, of all books, is one of my favorites, if not my favorite book of the year, which is Reinventing American Healthcare by Ezekiel Emanuel.
That's Rahm Emanuel's brother, isn't
correct.
It?
Correct. And he, Zeke is also was at our store for Brothers Emanuel, which was a story about three brothers. But what this is, Zeke worked in the Obama administration on the Affordable Care Act, and this tells you, people have lots of questions and opinions, and this tells you everything you might want to know about the Affordable Care Act. And what I find, again, as a history buff, really interesting, is he goes into great historical detail about how our medical system got messed up in the way that it currently is, and what the history of all the reforms movements are. So for anyone's interested in learning that, this is kind of a sleeper book that I really like.
Actually, that sounds so good to me. I'm like, oh, okay, this will be one on my next list.
Yeah.
Well, he had an article recently in the Atlantic Monthly.
Correct.
Why he wanted to die at 75.
Well, no, that's not exactly true.
That's not exactly true.
That's
right.
We've had a lot of debates and discussions with our family about that article.
Yeah. That was the title, I think, of the article, but that wasn't really what he meant. You're right. Anyway, go ahead.
The book that just came out that I'm really looking forward to reading, and I haven't had a chance to read yet, I've just skimmed through, is The Churchill Factor, How One Man Made History by Boris Johnson, who's the mayor of London. And again, back in the day, there was a lot of debate about whether it was really the Marxist view of history that there are really these waves and tides of progress that come along and that individuals really make very little impact on what happens, versus traditional history school, which you've read about great leaders and how they were able to make their mark on history by their own unique events. And Boris Johnson's clearly coming down on that side by talking about how Winston Churchill on his own was able to make such a huge impact on British history and world history. And I've read excerpts. It's very lively. It's great reading. I think
Well, Johnson, I just heard the other day, he's actually an American, or he retains dual citizenship. He's a mayor of London, but he's an American citizen. Yeah. Okay. But Churchill's an intriguing figure. Are there any others that,
biographies? Sure, but I want to give Melissa.
Oh, okay.
Well, I'll do one.
I think that's all we're going to have time for.
Oh, no, you got to show your two fiction ones. Okay. I just wanted to say The Price of Paradise, which we had a community coalition lecture. And, the libraries have it, and you have it at Words, right?
Yes.
And I've only read part of it, but the lecture was fascinating. You can get the NPR podcast talking about it. It was really interesting stuff, especially for South Orange Maplewood. Okay, let me hold those up for you.
Yeah, just two big fiction books. We Are Not Ourselves, a novel by Matthew Thomas, and Orphan Train by Christina Baker Klein. They're actually both Montclair authors.
Mm. So is David Trapp.
There you go. Well, we have plenty, here in South Orange Maplewood as well. But these are both fiction works having to do with Irish families. The Orphan Train is about a fictionalized story about how, around the turn of the century, how Irish children who were homeless or orphaned were sent out west by train to be with new families. And this is kind of an epic saga of marriage and family life. But it's this author's first book, and it's been a huge bestseller hit. In contrast to Christina, who's written many novels, and this book came out and did not immediately receive acclaim, but grew by word of mouth and became a national bestseller. And it's just a fantastic book. And as you mentioned, book clubs, it's usually popular with book clubs and with everyone. It's a great book.
I think it's a selection of... A friend of mine has a book club, and I think that's their current selection. So, well, that's, I guess, speaking of trains, I think our train's run out of the station. I think this is all the time we have, so thank you for joining us on Books in Action, and good reading to you.